So tonight we're actually gonna dive into we're being on, a series of these things, and tonight we're actually gonna dive into the topic how to rightly divide the word of God, how to rightly divide the truth, really boil down to how can we study the Bible effectively, which is as you know is absolutely essential as a believer, as a Christian, so we know really the Bible, not just read the Bible. Not just maybe have surface understanding of it, but truly understand the Word of God, because in it is the instruction of life, what the Lord has given us, everything that we need to know while we're on earth. So Riley, I'm gonna turn it to you to kick us off.
Yeah, amen. Amen. Yeah, to say the importance of this is it's of utmost, because taking this book for what it actually is it's life. This is the constitution, not
Absolutely.
only the constitution of a kingdom, but this book, the author of this book holds the very fabric of space and time together around us by his word. And that word became
Exactly.
flesh and dwelt among us.
That's right. Exactly.
So jumping right in, I mean, we know that the Bible is the books of canon, and there's we weren't originally going to go into this, Kevin, but it is something that I hear a lot, when they're disputing the Bible. Oh, the Council of Nicaea. Well, they came together because there was so much perversion of what was the actual needed scripture and relevant scripture versus what these other ideas were. So what the Council of Nicaea actually did is it was a group of people coming together and saying, what here is incongruency and what is disruptive? And we need to bring this together and make clear what's actually clear and consistent with each other. And from that place, they ended with 66 books that ended up in the canon. 39 of those came through the Septuagint, which is the Greek Old Testament. 27 were copies of the original manuscripts from the first apostles, and letters that were brought throughout the church through Paul and the others who wrote the New Testament. So we're not going to go too much deeper into what the Bible is. If you want some references for that, there's some new resources out there that talk about the hyperlinks online. If you look up the first hyperlink book, you'll find that there's over 63,000 connections between the Old and New Testaments that are fascinatingly only God. Those number of references just blow your mind on. When somebody says this is written by a bunch of men, it's abs that whole narrative gets crushed by that hyperlink illustration that you can easily find now. But Kevin, what we know is that Bible illiteracy is a huge problem within the church today.
Absolutely.
And the thing that we know that we see as the biggest failure is context. Because when we have these different denominations who take one thing and they stand on it as a sacred cow, and then that's it, and then they oftentimes end up in some form of godliness without any demonstration of real power or grace or humility or love, et cetera, et cetera. That's a real issue. But Kevin, why don't you jump into a bit about the Greek and the Hebrew? Because that is something I think the context of understanding the different languages that this stuff was actually spoken of and understood through those lenses is actually a really big deal when it comes to our English version.
I think that's important to understand, right? Because to set the context, there's thousands of languages on earth today, right? There's thousands and thousands. If you just go to Wycliffe Bible Translator, they've been around for decades. They want to translate the Bible to every known language and tongue on earth. And if you look at the website, you can see there's literally thousands of different language probably you never knew they existed. The reason I said that is important is that a lot of time, Western Christianity, American, right? We largely consume the Bible, our Bible, in English. And sometimes we may have the perception that English is the central universe of the language of gods, right? But that's clearly not the case. That's not what it is. Originally, the book it largely kind of Ryland kind of give you some references, and we encourage you to do more research. So this podcast is not meant for diving deep into the origin, the history of the Bible, none of that. we're not going to dive deep in the Greek language itself or the Hebrew itself, but want to just keep in a quick context to dive into how you can practically study the Bible. That's the foundation we want to set and be able to impart to you some very practical and biblical grounding as everyday Christians, disciple of Christ, how we can really understand the Word of God so our daily walk with the Lord can be more enriched, can be more fulfilled, and allowing the Holy Spirit to truly illuminate the words. And Greek, as you know, it's a two different language. The Bible is written, the mostly of the New Testament is written in Greek, the Greek language, which is a different language, completely different language versus the Hebrew language. The Old Testament are written by some, a little bit of Aramaic, but it's mostly Hebrew, right? Which is entire sets of different language. Both language is not the same as the English language in itself, and even compared to a lot of language. And the reason I mentioned this, I was thinking about this the other day, actually, Rylan, when I was thinking about even Chinese, right? So for those know me, I was born in Taiwan. So I know Mandarin Chinese. And if you ever, and I encourage you to pick up, if you ever pick up a Chinese Bible, and if you look at the character, how it's written, the translation, and you take English and the Chinese Bible side by side, if you know the language, you would clearly tell the difference. And the nuances of translation is not quite the same. It's not quite the same. Because guess what? Chinese language itself, like Hebrew and Greek, is a complete different language, right? Which again need to be translated. I would say Hebrew language in the base itself is not meant to go deep in Hebrew, but a lot of the language in the character means certain things. So it's not really alphabet, but the language system in Hebrew, it is a little bit more character based type of language, right? Meaning the typology and the shape describe something of a picture almost, and that kind of translate into the language. It's very similar in Chinese, because Chinese character are very complex. The word actually elephant actually derived from the picture of an elephant. So if you look at it's like drawing on the cave. So it basically simplified the picture of drawing of an elephant. Then the character of actually the word itself is came from that. So there's connection to that. The reason I bring those things in context, saying that it's more complex than what you think. So when you read the English Bible, not all translation, no translation are perfect. I would say no translation are perfect. There's prefer scholar and theologian prefer certain translation. For example, I prefer New King James, right? Or ESV. Those are the two mostly go-to translations. I would not recommend Passion translation. It's very inaccurate. I know people might disagree with me there, but it's very inaccurate. I would not recommend that translation. But even in the translation itself we pick, we have to understanding this is a translation. Hence, the original language is not such, right? It's Greek and Hebrew. And there's a tool I want to kind of introduce there really quickly before kind of going some key principle and sort of how we can study the Bible, Riley. Is I use Bible Hub. There's a Blue Letter Bible. There's all kind of different Bible software that are good out there. Personally, when people ask me all the time, what do I use? I use Bible Hub quite often, right? In terms of studying the Bible. I think I have a pretty good study Bible itself, my paper Bible here. But in terms of software, I use Bible Hub. Because there's all this commentary is there. There's very different lexicon, Strong, and different version of concordance is there. You can easily reference. And one quick tip I just shared you right off the bat, a good way to study the Bible in terms of the original context, which is the first principle we're going to go into, is that when you go to, say, Bible Hub, and you go to a verse, right? I highly recommend go to interlinear of that verse. So you can scroll down the verse, so you want to drop down, go to click on interlinear, the tab. And what it does is that it give you the original, whether it's Hebrew or Greek, how it is written. So you can see the original Greek or original Hebrew, depends on New or Old Testament. Then you see the English underneath that. So the English now is dictated by the original. So it's versus the other way around. that is interesting read, because now you read the English, it's like, wow, it's like a weird language, the way they're talking, right? It grammatically does not quite make sense, but it gives you a little bit understanding of translation, right? Again, context. Then the other things that what I like about, you can see sometimes one Greek word or one Hebrew word is actually three English words. So what does that tell you? It's not one for one, right? That's not how language system works. And so when you click on, and then you can click on the actual Greek or actual Hebrew word of whatever the translation is, then you can see what the original meaning, you know, strong, concordance, lexicon, all this stuff, translation, and give you a lot of most of the scholars' commentary, right, usually right next to it. So you can read and get context, because some of the translation, maybe, sometimes we translate something to be something in English. For example, the word peace. Well, the word peace, we may translate things into peace, the word in the Bible, but the original in Greek and Hebrew are different words. They may not be the same words, may have different meanings, but we all translate in English the word peace, but they're coming from two different words. So without jumping too much there, but just giving you context, that's a really good tools, again, to help you study the Bible, get a foundation. But a couple of fun facts before we go to the first things I want to talk about is really a key and foundation, how to study the Bible. But this fun facts is that, I don't know if many of you guys know this, right? Throughout the Bible, right? So you think about it, there's two different places named Antioch. There's three names that use for the Sea of Galilee. There's six different people named Mary in the Bible. There's three different people named James. 10 people named Simon, two different people named Philip, and four or five different people named John, right? So, and of course, I'm just referencing mostly the first name and a couple of places in itself. So it can create complexity and confusion. So hence about dividing the word rightly, right? Really understand the word of God, because there's seemingly in the word of God, you will find scripture, there's seeming like contradicting. So Lord, I thought you came to bring peace, but what do you mean you want to use a sword to divide my family?
Right.
I thought you're the Prince of Peace. Like, which one are you? So with that said, I think we need to jump in. The first key is about understanding context in the Bible matters. When you study the Bible, foundationally, we have to know context. Context is absolutely crucial. And Paul says, and he declared, the whole counsel of the word of God in scripture matters, right? This is in Acts 20:27. So we must consider every scripture for valid context and accept scripture is the absolute, final, inspired word of God, author from the Lord himself, right? In 2 Timothy 3:16, that talks about that. So you cannot, it's very dangerous. And now I see a lot of people do that, especially in the charismatic world, which is unfortunate. I'm a charismatic, I'm a continuous, but I see a lot of, unfortunately, in the charismatic Pentecostal world, abuse, misuse of scripture quite often, and build something out of doctrine, out of a few different verses, without a clear exegesis of the context there. So you cannot build a doctrine when something just didn't spoke enough in terms of context and reference in the Bible. So that's a key there. Solid biblical truth must be established with a minimum of two or more scripture, I would even say passages, to create what we call sound doctrine. It's not just minimum two verses. No, that's not enough, right? We need to look at clear passages, thematic things that's referencing scripture. Hence, multiple of these in connection creates doctrine. And that's the whole counsel of truth, the word of God. Matthew 18:16 talks about, 2 Corinthians 13:1 also talks about that. So it helps us from getting, you know, into error, getting to false doctrine and create like an actual doctrine out of very minor issue that we see here and there in the Bible, right? When we have difficulty, maybe try to reconcile what seems contradicting in itself. So those things are super important in terms of understanding context. And one thing, it's quick, it, again, this podcast is about giving you practical tips. So One easy way to understand context in the Bible is that when I have a question, a verse, right? And I will try to read five verse before and five verse after.
Mm.
So that's the easy way, practical tip. So if you have a verse you don't quite understand, well, you feel like there's contradictory, I would take that verse, go five verse before, read all five before that verse, and read all five verse after. Now, if that doesn't give you context in terms of better understanding, what is the historical knowledge is trying to talk in the Bible? I would say read the whole chapter. If the chapter doesn't do it for you, read the chapter before and read the chapter after, right? Mm. If that doesn't do it for you, read the book, whatever book that you're reading through. Again, this is the right way to understand context in the Bible. And two things, practical tip, just want to add. Most Bible has cross-reference, right? So you see the tiny letters next to, even digital Bible has it, next to the verse of scripture, like B, C, A, then they either in the middle footer or the bottom footer has this scripture. Those also help you because most, you know, scholar, even the most basic Bible, some of the things they already done in terms of cross-reference, right? In terms of what is the connection of this verse with other parts of the verses in the Bible. That's also a great way to cross-reference on context. And most Bible all has cross-reference. So that's a very fundamental, very basic, elementary way to get some better understanding of the passage, that you're trying to understand there. Amen? And a couple of things, I wanna just give you 5 points. Some of the things I kind of mentioned it, but just succinctly, I wanna give you five main points to consider when you're studying the passage in the Bible. One, the immediate passage of text. What does it really mean? Like, what does it mean in the chapter, in the passage? Consider culture, consider background, consider signs of the time when it is written, right? That's the place you gotta first come from before you try to draw any prophetic application, before you need to think about typology. Those things, they are important. There is a place for that, but we need to understand how to use them the right place. Then the other one, just understand the book which is written with, I talked about that a little bit right now. Other book by the Bible with the same author, right? Especially, is there reference of the same similar passage? Again, cross-reference comes to help that talks about the same thing, but it's in different books of the Bible. And then number four is that, you know, looking at the entirety of text, Old or New Testament, and of course, then look at and turn the Bible, obviously. And pattern matters. So before I jump into some other tips, pattern speaks volume. So if you can see a continuous pattern throughout scripture, like Old Testament, New Testament, or the connection, the interconnection of the two. So if you see a clear pattern of something, that also can be a reference and validate what you are studying versus kind of stretch the text, like take something, it does not apply to something else. A few things, and then Rylan, I'll flip it back to you. Things to identify when examining the text, right? This is important. Practicality here is who's speaking in the text. Who's speaking? Is it Paul? Moses? Is it written by a third person? That matters. Like, who is actually speaking there? Who's being spoken to? Like Paul, you know, the letter Ephesians. These are letter to the church, meaning Paul speaking to the church, right? To the body in another region, another place there. When did this happen, right? This happened, before the flood, after Noah. When did it happen, right? I'm just giving some analogy there. Where did this happen, right? Samaria, you know, what, Damascus, whenever that is. What is the main thing? Like, what is this particular passage maybe talking about? And what is being said?
Yeah. So the next principle that we're going to talk about, everyone, is the principle of literal meaning in the Bible. And this is where we know a lot of denominations and kind of more humanist perspectives will start trying to do spiritual interpretations of what God means as to be literal. But the bottom line is that for us to study the Bible accurately, we must make every effort to take the Bible literally for what it says, unless we are forced to do otherwise wherever possible. You know, there's these ideas like replacement theology that the Gentile church is replacing Israel. It's just an example that is a rabbit hole that you see out there. That is not a biblical one, not a sound looking at the entire Old and New Testaments at all. But what taking the scripture literally enables us to develop is strong beliefs and exercise strong faith in the word of God and the demonstration of God's power when we become doers of the word. But there is a difference between taking the word literally and being legalistic in an unloving manner. Churches that are big on rules and do not develop relationship and intimacy with the Holy Spirit, they start policing each other, and that's a real issue because they're out of grace and they're into striving and works in a way that is not bringing peace and grace. God says that the Bible is spirit and it's life. And when we mix faith with the declaration of the word, with the understanding of the difference between water baptism and the baptism of fire and the Holy Spirit, and actually biblically walking through those processes, you will encounter the living God. And you will know that you are not in a form of godliness through wisdom and analytical study of the scriptures almost the word I'm looking for is studying it as a theological advancement instead of an active living relationship. Because the anointing in that Greek word, it almost means like smearing or rubbing. And that what that means is that God's presence actually joins with us and we function together as we step into more and more of receiving the word and then applying it as the Holy Spirit's leading us to apply it in our lives.
Yeah, absolutely.
So these terms like eisegesis and exegesis, right? And what that basically is looking at is we have to look at the entirety of what Jesus said, for example, in the New Testament, and not just take one little point that he says and build a whole doctrine on it. But again, I won't go into that because you just covered a whole bunch on context. But we need to take what Jesus said literally, but we need to understand his heart behind all that he said in an exegesis way. That means, okay, so then when would he want to apply a declaration or a statement like that versus a declaration or a statement like this? When did he keep his mouth shut when he was being accused? And when did he sharply rebuke in love versus sharply rebuke in what we might perceive as not as much love? Because all of those things have a context that's important. And it's only by the Spirit that we're going to know when to apply what when we're, you know, in Jude, for example, save some with compassion and save some with fear. Well, it's only by the Spirit that we're going to really know if that's effective or not. And the Spirit's probably going to let us know if we do one on our own understanding and then it wasn't the right thing to do.
Yeah, I was going to jump in real quick, Rylan. And the point that, again, to just the conversation that Rylan and I are having right now, this is about really fortify ourselves and strengthen our faith so we would not be tossed and to and fro for every wind of doctrine. I want to quote a scripture I didn't get a chance to quote earlier. It's 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 9. 2 Thessalonians 2, 9. It says, The coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan, with all power, signs, and lying wonders. So again, we talked about, we covered last time, false supernatural. You definitely want to check out that podcast. We really covered about what is the false look like, right? Because clearly says that again. With all unrighteous deception among those who perish because they did not receive the love of what? The love of truth. The love of truth. Right. So if we're not anchored by the word of God, by the sound doctrine of the Bible, every time we see some kind of supernatural, we can gravitate towards to it, think it's the Lord when it's not the Lord.
Yeah.
There's many, like a scripture, the spirit antichrist is already here. There is false prophet already here. Right. So there's a counterfeit Jesus has infiltrated the church. So it's more than ever before as believers, you know, everyday believers, you and I, you don't have to be ministry, you don't have to be a pastor, or anything, everyday believer, disciple of Christ, we really need to go deep in the scripture and understand what the scripture said and read it for yourself. Don't just take somebody's sermon. Don't just take somebody's YouTube video just because it has a million view. That is the word of the living God, right? It can be, but not necessarily is. You have to verify. You have to be accountable. And you have to study the word for yourself. So all those things are super important. And that's the reason why I feel that as part of the Kingdom Matters to have this part of the conversation, really how do some of the basic fundamental thing do when you really need how to study the Bible rightly.
Amen. So just to finish up this principle, you know, there are some places where we're not to take it literally, and you know, hopefully, as adults we can know that when Jesus says I am the door, he's not a literal door. He is the Son of God. No. Or that when he says, I'm the bread of life, that he is not the loaf of bread in your fridge. No, that's not him. But we've heard crazy stories about denominations. There's a story I heard about the scripture, John 12:35, walk while you have the light, lest darkness overtake you. One denomination leaving the light on and never wanting to turn a light off while they go to sleep at night because of that scripture. So
that's right.
There's all kinds of lying, deceiving little spirits that want to get you to be hyper analytical and hyper crazy about one little thing over another. And that really jumps us into the next principle, which is emphasis. Kevin, mm-hmm. if you want to jump into emphasis now.
Yeah, absolutely. Emphasis is not the key. So we understand Bible highlights certain things for a reason. So also emphasis has to do what I call another principle when you study the Bible. This is well known. Among scholars is, you know, if you look at emphasis of the law of first mention, like this is the first time it happened in the Bible. Well, there's a reason why it happened here. Here is the genesis of something transpired. So that can be emphasis. And the other one is double reference. When you say, surely, surely, therefore, etc. You know, when you see the double reference of something, and Jesus did that a lot of his teaching, his parable, surely, surely, I must truly, truly, that those double reference matter, meaning pay special attention to what is about to be said, right? Really hear the context. Yeah. So those things really matters. So people, I'm say something, hopefully it doesn't bring confusion, but bring deeper clarity. People think everything in the Bible is absolutely equal. That is true. The entirety of the Bible is the inspired word of God, period. Is the absolute truth. But in itself, that's kind of the foundation. There's depth, there's layer, there's degree. There's depth, there's layers, there's degree. So not everything in the Bible is always the same, right? Because why the Lord say, surely, surely, meaning there's an emphasis that he's tried to drive there through the double reference. He's referencing double for a purpose. So this is really an important part of it if we look at this. If you go to 2 Peter, I want to just read this part of scripture. I think it's important. 2 Peter 3:15-16. And consider that the long-suffering of our Lord is salvation, as also our beloved brother Paul, according to the wisdom given to him, has written to you, as also to all of his epistle, meaning doctrines, you know, his writings, speaking in them of these things, in which some of these things are hard to understand, right? So you say it may not be easy to understand, which untaught, unstable people twist to their own destruction, as they do also with the rest of scripture. Now, so the highlight is basically telling you there are people. They're manipulating, abusing the scripture for their own purpose, for their own gain, unfortunately, right? Yeah. So understanding this principle of emphasis, along with some of the other ones I mentioned, really helps people refrain and creates a healthy boundary to guide us as we go deeper in the truth without exclusion of other truth, right? So a couple of examples I kind of want to mention here. I think we have it in our notes. If I'm not, I want to mention this. I'm going to jump right this to, because I hear this a lot. There's three examples I'm going to share. And this is a little bit of paradox I mentioned earlier in the beginning. I hear people use this verse all the time, prophetic circle, or the charismatic circle, or in sermon. I think it's a gross misuse of the verse. So Isaiah 43:19. Behold, I am doing new thing. The old thing has passed away. The new thing has come. And they quote a few more verses, right? We all know that passage of verse. If you read Isaiah 46, that is not the context of what Isaiah is doing. But we tend to use that one verse and trying to pull the prophetic application. Now, there can be application. I'm not saying there cannot be, but there's a gross misuse, exaggeration thereof. I mean, you hear all the time. Look on YouTube. Everybody say, oh, behold, the Lord said Isaiah 40. That's not the context of the scripture. And I'm even interested. I'm going to go there right now, Ryland. This is off the cuff.
43:19.
Yes, Isaiah 43:19. That's right. Sorry. If I say something else, my Chinese kick in.
You said 46. You said 46.
Sorry. 43:19. Ryland's my Grammarly here.
My Chinese kicked in. That's a good joke.
it's my Chinese kicking. Sorry.
We were seeing in pictures.
you were seeing pictures. But see, the context, Isaiah 43, that whole chapter is talking about how is the reinsurance, providential care of God to God's people and the redemption from captivity, right? And hence the captivity specifically is talking about God's deliverance from Israel. And that's what Prophet Isaiah was mentioning in itself. Then fast forward to that area of the passage, which is 19, right? I'm going to read from, just so you know the context there. This is kind of interesting. So I'm going to read from verse 15. 43:15. I am the Lord, Holy One, the Creator of Israel, your King. Thus says the Lord, who makes the way in the sea a path through the mighty waters, who brings forth chariot and horses, the army and the power. They shall lie down together and shall not rise. They shall be extinguished. They shall be quenched like a wick. Do not remember the former things, nor consider things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Shall it not come forth? Shall you not know it? Will I not make a road in the wilderness, river in the desert? Blah, blah, blah. Then verse 20 actually say, which I don't see many people quote this, right? Verse 20, it says, the beast of the field will honor me. The jackal and ostrich, because I have given the water in the wilderness, the river in the desert, to give drink to my people, my chosen. This I have formed for myself. They shall declare my praise. I don't hear many people quote the rest of it. So Isaiah is describing a context of deliverance, but it's not meant to try to pull forth as a prophetic application in every incident. Again, wrong emphasis is our point. Wrong context, right? Another one's famous is Luke 6:38. This is I hear this verse being abused a lot, especially in the word of faith circle. They use this verse for giving, right? For fundraising. So Luke 6:38, give and shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and run over into your bosom. For the same measure you will use, it will be measured back to you. Now, if you actually read Luke 6, there is some context. The Lord is teaching what I would call kingdom principles, how the kingdom of God works, right? So I'm going to go there for a second there, just for the conversation, because I think this is, because I really want you guys to get this in terms of a practical practical application. I'm going to Luke 6 here. Hope you guys are getting something out of this conversation tonight. Okay. So if you look at the passage itself, right, that's Luke 6:38. I just quote. But if you look at 35, well, even before, even starting from verse 27, is all of talking about how to love your enemies, actually. So it's not just about giving. It's not about sowing and reaping. It's about how to love your enemies. That was a theme of that entire passage from verse 27 and onward. Then verse 37 and onward is about how to not judge. So the context of give unto given is actually the context that we're talking about. The theme is judgment. Do not judge. To the measure that you be judged returned to you. You see what I'm saying? So although there is application in here about perhaps sowing and reaping, but it's not exclusively financial. It's not exclusively financial, which a lot of, again, Christian minister misusing that. And the last thing, right, I'm turning to you, is Romans 2:4. Right, it is, we quote this a lot. This is about emphasis. Remember, when we taking one scripture, we have to also think about the context in other places of the scripture, right? Cross-reference, like I mentioned. So Romans 2:4, it says, it is the love of God that leads you to repentance. We quote that all the time. It is the love of God, love of God, love of God. Yes, it is love of God. Absolutely agree. But we cannot take the love of God alone exclusively and abandoning the fear of God. It doesn't work like that. That's not how God works. That's not how scripture works. So also in 2 Corinthians 7:10. So 2 Corinthians 7:10, you know what it talks about? It is the sorrow of God that leads you to repentance. It is the sorrow, the remorse, the conviction of God. So it is both love and the sorrow of God, which has to do with the fear of the Lord. So it's both Romans 2:4 and 2 Corinthians 7:10. So you got to take both scripture in context together to understand a better picture of how God moves upon people's heart and lead them into repentance. Rylan, you want to jump here? Anything to add?
Amen and amen. Somebody, we don't have a specific quote on this, but somebody said the truth is often found somewhere between two extremes. Mm-hmm. And we need to balance these things. Like that's a perfect example of one. The love of God, the sorrow of God, the fear of God. You could throw Isaiah 11 in there. The fear of God is what is going to end up bringing you the authentic spirit of wisdom, understanding, and revelation. In the knowledge of the Son, jumping to Ephesians 1:17, open the eyes of your understanding, et cetera, et cetera. All those scriptures could flow together. Because the focus is maintaining a balance of emphasizing certain truths while still being firmly rooted in the eternal truths of Christ and his redemptive work as the pillar and foundation of the rock that we are standing on. And it's what we see a lot of times is people arguing and tit for tatting in conversations, trying to, you know, horse trade over who knows better this or other thing about these littler things when we're standing on the same rock, guys. Let's stop picking up pebbles.
Exactly. That's a great analogy, right? We're all supposed to be standing upon the chief cornerstone. That's just so ironic. Go ahead.
Yeah. So we're jumping forward now to the next principle. So this one, we're going to just have a little bit more of a conversation about, a little bit less teaching, but basically this is now the principle of application. So to start out, doing and not only hearing, according to James 1:22 and 25, so much of this form of godliness, yet not seeing any demonstration of power, is what I believe is what much, if not most of the church is missing. It's not just the demonstration of power, which we all love. We all want to see it. We need to see it for the authentic gospel to be preached. We know that Paul said, my word did not come to you in cunning wisdom of man or theological, you know, working things through just in our thoughts and our words, but demonstration of power. So James 1:22 and through 25 says that but be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving ourselves. If we are only hearers, we deceive. We are in blatant deception if we only hear and don't do, is what he's saying here. he's like a man observing his natural face in a mirror, for he observes himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of a man he was. Wow. But he who looks into the perfect law of liberty, freedom, and continues in it, and is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this one will be blessed in what he does. And this is unto James 1:27, that what God honors, what God loves, what he calls undefiled religion, is to visit orphans and widows in their trouble and to keep oneself unspotted, which means completely pure before God in your hands and heart. And I wasn't going to go into this, Kev, but I want to touch on this little testimony, because I have had the experience of this doing homeless ministry in New York. There is no greater love that I believe a human being can experience physically, viscerally, tangibly. And I'm talking about all the love that even you might experience in a perfect godly marriage or an undefiled marriage bed. I have peered my eyes into someone on the street who truly believed that their life was of no service to anyone and that no one in this world was for them at all. And I've been able to watch my presence, my love, my attention, and my words being God's words, led by the Spirit in that moment, bring that person an encounter with the love and presence of God. And I believe that that's ultimately what we are created for, to experience what an orphan or a widow truly feels like at the end of their rope, and to be the conduit of God's love in that moment that literally brings the visceral power of their life to death, I mean, death to life experience. They're meeting the living God in that moment. I've had a couple of those that have just had me undone and weeping with the person.
Wow, that's powerful.
So yeah, I just felt to share that testimony, because basically, I mean, this principle is about application. This principle is about, we overcome by the blood of the Lamb, the word of our testimony, and not loving our lives unto martyrdom, possibly, or death. And so, you know, I can tell you, Kev, I've had some of these experiences where, oh my goodness, like summer of 2022, I'm on a little trip with some Christians at a lake house, and this, you know, new kid, new to the faith, 13, 14 years old, he's got one of those little blue stainless steel silver splints on his finger. And I just nonchalantly said, as I met him, we're sitting out by the dock, I said, you know, God can heal that, right? And he goes, oh, okay, I don't know. And I just said a simple prayer. And I just said, can I pray? And he said, yes. And I didn't barely touch him. I might have laid my hand on his hand, or had him lay his hand on my hand. And I just said, by your stripes, Lord, this finger is whole and healed in Jesus' name. And he goes, oh, he goes, the pain just left. And I'm just like, praise God, it wasn't me. And I pointed up, and then nothing else really happened in that moment. 10 minutes later, we're in the kitchen and we're starting to get some dinner stuff together. There's a bunch of people running around. He suddenly, 10 minutes later, runs up to me with the splint off, wiggling his finger as if nothing had been wrong with it.
Wow.
And 2 weeks later, his mother sends me the X-ray from the doctors, and the doctors said, we have no idea, because this finger was as if it had never been broken, and here's the X-ray that's showing it completely healed.
Wow, that's powerful.
And so, I mean, that's the word becoming the phosphorus, magnesium, calcium, all that bone that got healed right there. That's the minerals coming into this out of the spirit and into the natural, into that word that was declared over him.
Yeah, that's regenerative power. Talking about application, right? And that's what James said, what he said. I think the key notion into kind of just even, you kind of spark a few different things that when you were sharing the testimony in this part itself, I think it's crucial. Because think about, I'm going to challenge even people. I'm going to stress some of you even today right now. As important as the word of God, did Moses has the word of God? No. He didn't have it until the Lord gave him the Ten Commandments, right? And then he wrote the Ten Commandments. What about Abraham? What about Joseph? What about Daniel? None of them have this, what we call Bible.
Right.
This gives a tremendous advantage to us in this age of believer, we're in the age of grace, right? For such a time as this, we have advantage because we have this. A lot of patriarch and matriarch of the old, they did not have the word of God. Not think about Paul and the new first century apostle, disciples and others. They were writing it. They were writing the letters, which turns into what we in our Bible today. They didn't really have it in the way that we have it today.
Yeah.
But they put it into practice. Hence the application, to your point, right? The application part is crucial, that we will understand the word of God rightly, right? The proper context, and we put it into our everyday life. We infuse in our decision making. We allow it to be embedded in terms of how we view the world. Our worldview should be based biblically, right? Because that matters a lot in everything we do. And the reminding me of the scripture in 1 Samuel 15:22 is that obedience is better than sacrifice, right? Yeah. Scripture clearly talks about faith without works is dead. That's what they're really talking about. It's not trying to talk about performance. It's about how you actually apply the word into reality so we can exercise when we have been empowered by the Holy Spirit. And see, because that's what the Great Commission is all about in Matthew 28. You say, greater things shall you do, right? That's clearly,
yep.
The Bible says it. And that part of it, we should take it literal. We're talking about the principle of literal meaning. That is literal meaning. The Lord says, preach the gospel to all creatures, all nations, all tribes and tongues, make disciple to all nations, right? And he said it. Those things are literally what he meant. It was not like a prophetic type and shadow. Symbolically, Jesus was trying to describe something else. He meant exactly was said there. So it's important that we take those things into application, into everyday life. And again, I want to really challenge and also encourage, you don't have to be a minister of any kind, any fivefold. You as a believer, as a disciple of Christ, we have the responsibility to do this very thing, to take the word of God, put into application, and see it come to life in our everyday life. Sharing the gospel, preaching to someone, praying like Ryland prayed, the homeless person. And remind me of one story as a quick testimony before we jump to the last one. I think was it really interesting. This is early on, this is a few years back in ministry, when I just started doing more kind of like a Zoom discipleship meetings. I remember one day somebody got invited. I didn't even know how they came on. I really did not know. And this was on Zoom. It was not on YouTube. And apparently she came to know our ministry recently, so jumped on and we were doing the Bible study. Of course, we always pray at the end of the Bible study, so we pray for the people. And then she brought on, I think her mother, I think her aunt, you know, I'm not 100%. Her mother was basically relative, two older lady. Her mother and her, I say, and they were broken in Spanish, right? They wasn't speaking English very well. So the lady said, hey, can you pray for my aunt? I think she, and then she translated. She's having cancer. And I didn't know even how severe the cancer was or anything of that nature. They didn't give me a lot of detail. So she's going through chemo. She's having cancer. Can you pray for her? I said, sure, I'll pray for her. So I started praying for her and I felt the power and anointing God came on, right? I exercise what I'm called to do, pray for the sick. They shall recover, right? So I exercise the authority and pray over and start rebuking the cancer, spirit infirmity, thing in nature. I just felt such anointing that night to pray for this lady, this elder lady. And I start calling up prophetic things. So I start calling out, you know, I rebuke specific things about the cancer, which I didn't have foreknowledge before that because they didn't tell me what it was.
Word of knowledge in operation.
Yeah, word of knowledge start in operation. So I start, as I getting the word now, I was praying over her. I just felt so, and because I can see her on Zoom, she started weeping and crying because I can feel that the power and the presence of God is all over this lady. She was weeping and crying, and she said, I feel such a warm sensation, like flood my entire body.
Come on.
Well, long story short, fast forward, they tell me she has stage 4 breast cancer. I didn't know. They didn't even tell me that night. They told me that later on, right? Mm. They told me she has stage 4 breast cancer. And she say she doesn't feel the lumps anymore. Lumps gone. I was like, well, don't just go by that. Go check. Go to the doctor, right? I can't believe it. I always tell people, go verify your healing. Go to the doctor and check, please. Make sure you do. And apparently, this lady came back and tell me she went back to the doctor, and the doctor said, cancer's no trace. The cancer's not there. There's no cancer. It's gone. On. The cancer. She was in the midst of chemo.
Jesus.
Stage 4. So my point, that was not me. That was the power of the Holy Spirit. But I obey the word. Mm-hmm. I obey the word by faith and exercise our authority in Christ.
Come on. Praise God.
Shall we jump into
testimony. So the last one is the principle of spiritual concepts. So these are things that are not mentioned overtly by name. But you want to spearhead this one, Kev?
Yeah, so think about the concept of Trinity, right? Mm. Is the word Trinity actually in the Bible? No. Hopefully, you know, the answer is no.
Yep.
But is the concept of Trinity in the Bible? Yes. Very clear. The Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, right? Yep. So again, that's a spiritual concept. If you want to call it a spiritual concept, or you even call it a spiritual principle, whatever, I hate to use the word, whatever floats your boat in terms of however you want to use the adjective there, but it's representing something that's powerful. Even the law of sowing and reaping, right? Unfortunately, there is missing abuse financially in many church and organization ministry, which I do not condone that, right? You know, unfortunately, the prosperity gospel has polluted a lot of those things and made it very confusing. This is very unfortunate. However, the law of sowing and reaping is real. Just because somebody misused and abused it doesn't mean it's not true. The law of sowing and reaping is real if you use it properly and understand what it really means, right? It's not guaranteed you sow XYZ, you gotta instantly reap XYZ. It's not you sow $1,000, you're gonna guarantee this. No, that's false doctrine. But when you sow apple seed, what are you gonna get? You're gonna get an apple tree. And if you nourish it, cultivate it, you're gonna get apple on that tree. Same thing, if you plant an orange tree, what are you gonna get? You're gonna get orange, right? That the manifestation of is super clear throughout the Bible. When you sow something, you will reap. Even the concept of that, I'm just using that spiritual concept, even in Matthew 25, just thought about it, parable of talent. It's about sowing, it's about taking the talent, that what the master has given them in that story, and then multiply it. You notice that there's a concept of multiplication. That's a concept, that's a spiritual concept through that parable in Matthew 25. And even in that in itself, because Jesus was talking about the parable, he said, even if one of the servants say, which is basically accusing the Lord, is you are the very hard taskmaster, right? You try to reap what you did not sow. And the Lord confirmed it in that parable, said, yes, I do, and I can reap and I did not sow. But what it does is a double-edged sword. It confirmed the law of sowing and reaping. It also said God is sovereign. He can supernaturally do things that only he can do.
Yeah.
So when we talk about these things, like 1 Corinthians, I'll turn it over to you, Ryan. In 1 Corinthians talks about, this is 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 13, is that these things we also speak not in words, which is the man's wisdom that teaches, but what the Holy Spirit teaches in comparison to spiritual thing with spiritual. But the natural man does not receive the things by the Spirit of God, for they are foolish to him, nor can he know them because they're spiritually discerned, right? Mm. So only know the things of God takes the Holy Spirit, basically, which is what he's trying to say. But he who is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself is rightly judged by no one. For who has the mind of the Lord, that he instructs to him, but we have the mind of Christ. So basically he's telling you, in order to understand the spiritual concept, takes the mind of Christ, which in order to have the mind of Christ, obviously you need to have him. You need to dwell in him, him in you, meaning you need to be born again, saved, filled with the Holy Spirit. So you can better understand the spiritual concept that are in the Word of God, and you can apply them. Go to the previous thing that we were talking about earlier.
Yeah, yeah. A couple of things just jumped up in my heart about this. So there is a place for human reasoning. Like earlier in the podcast, we were talking about leaving a light lamp on all night. That's not what that means. Yep. Jesus is not a door. These are these things that need to be spiritually discerned, but it's not at pertaining to trying to outsmart. We have to be subservient to the fact that, you know, I love is kind of sarcastic, but when people say, you know, this book was written by a bunch of men, well, then why would it go against all human desires to a degree and present a level of attainment that is completely unreachable without a completely supernatural God?
That's right.
Yeah. Right. So we have to stand only on our human reasoning to a degree of sense and not trying to outsmart or outthink. We have to be submissive to what these principles ultimately are presenting as who God is, who we are, and what our relational dynamics are that the redemptive work of Christ truly did pay for, and that it's not impossible for us to receive the fullness of that and walk in the fullness of that only by the grace of saying, okay, I'm not sure if that thought that I'm having or just had is from you, God. I'm going to learn how to actually test that, lay it before you, ask for your peace, your confirmation, your second, okay, that is you. And then you step forward into the fruit of that action, and then you actually see God show up again, and you're like, okay, that was you.
Yeah.
Right. That's really, right. Really important to understand that our thought life is, you know, we aren't our thoughts, and a lot of things live in unclean or improper thinking. And if there's three main sources of our thoughts are God, ourselves, soulish spirit part, and then essentially the enemy is the third major source, then we actually have to step into testing our thoughts against the Word of God, against the Spirit of God. And obviously if things that are coming into our head are discouraging and hopeless and, you know, then we need to potentially seek some inner healing and deliverance ministry. But just to wrap up this last principle, Kev, there are, in the study of doctrines of Scripture, there are valid and necessary conclusions that we must make to a degree. Studying spiritual concepts within the unchanging Scriptures will help the ever-changing spiritual, our ever-changing spiritual understanding grow.
That's right.
But ultimately, you know, this spiritual concept will help us to determine what we believe about God, and it will help us have the correct expectations of what God can or will do, which the hint is really anything's possible with him. Because at the end of the day, we must understand that the Word of God is absolute and inerrant, and that means complete and unchangeable. But our insight into that Word is constantly growing as we continue to study it and allow the Holy Spirit to unlock what he wants to unlock in terms of revelation. Because if God says it's better that I go, because I'm going to send you a helper and a teacher and a comforter that's going to lead you into, hold on, drop the mic, all truth.
All truth. All truth, yeah.
Whoa, that's heavy duty stuff.
Right.
Amen.
And and a couple of things just to wrap up what Rylan was kind of talked about, right? And for understanding spiritual concept, it's like building some of the foundational cornerstone and pillars in a house or in the building. Because what happened, those things will anchor and fortify you in the time of storm, in the time of trial, in the time of prosecution. So you have a clear understanding of different key pillars in the Word of God. These are what I'm using the word pillar, but essentially key spiritual concept in God's kingdom. So then when we have that framework, right, it helps us operate. So it is very important for us to understand some of the things are, right, as we go through it itself. But a couple of things I wanted to kind of share, and again, let me know. I love to see comment in the chat, even the replay, maybe perhaps, if there's anything that you might see. We would love to hear it. So anything we say there, you have comment, feedback, please put in the comment, even in the replay itself. And if you feel this is valuable, we can do part two, because there's more things actually to unpack in terms of how to study the Bible. You can even go deeper. Rylan and I just kind of select some very basic and fundamental things that really all believers, we need to know how to study and know the Word of God. So we kind of tease out those, I would say, key elements per se, but there's definitely a lot more stuff that we can go deeper in this topic. So if you want to, put in the chat, say if you want more of this, or if you want us to do a part two, put that in the comment and chat as well. Amen? Amen?
Amen.
So I just want to kind of pray into this particular issue tonight. And I would just want to declare the word of Lord. And Laura, I just lift this up right now, Holy Spirit. I bless you. I bless your leadership, because your leadership is perfect. We thank you, Lord, that you have revealed who you are. You're the Son of the living God. The Word became flesh and dwell among us. So, Father, I thank you for the revelation. I thank you for the wisdom, the understanding, the counsel, and the truth, and the light that shine forth in the mighty name of Jesus. Would you break in and break forth even right now? Let the word of the Lord sink deep into your people's heart. Let it be rooted and grounded in love, in faith. And Father, I pray this word will bear much fruit. It will help them, propel them to go deeper into the Word of God. They will know you and know you more by the power of the Holy Spirit. Give them greater understanding, greater revelation of your word, and teach your people how to apply your word in alignment, in accordance to your purpose and your plan for their life, God, I pray. Hallelujah, Lord. I bless everyone who's watching, everybody tuning in. I bless them and their household. May they encounter you, Lord. May they encounter you deeply, deeply. Give them a hunger. Give them such a hunger to seek you and your kingdom first and all of your righteousness, for all things shall be added unto them. Give them greater desire of your word, to study your word like never before. Hallelujah, Lord. We give you praise and glory and honor in Jesus' name.